Welcome to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Future technologies poised to transform our lives for better or worse are the focus of this podcast. Almost here means these technologies are now here and starting to be used, or just around the corner, from Bitcoin to artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more. Coming to Dallas, Texas, September 14th, 15th, and 16th, 2018, the Blockchain and Future Tech Expo. This is going to be a gigantic conference of over 5,000 people. We're going to be talking about blockchain and its applications. We're going to be talking about quantum computing, cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, and several other future technologies that are poised to and actually changing our lives as we speak. Here's why you should attend. As you may know, early adopters are the ones that investigated and profited from things like the gold rush in the 1800s, from the dot-com boom in the 1990s, from the internet boom in 2005, from the smartphone explosion in 2007, from the real estate boom that ended in 2008, and of course, from the Bitcoin boom that started in 2012. Early adopters act now. They don't wait till later. They go out west first in their covered wagons. They find the biggest gold nuggets. If you consider yourself an early adopter and you want to find the biggest nuggets, then you owe it to yourself to attend this upcoming conference. Blockchain is going to affect how we control and store our medical data, how we send money around the world, how we bank, and more. But artificial intelligence, quantum computing, and cybersecurity will play a pivotal role in our lives as well. And that's why our next event, September 14th to the 16th at the Dallas Convention Center, is going to have not only 5,000 plus attendees, but we'll showcase blockchain, AI, cybersecurity, quantum computing, and more. You want to get in on the coming gold rush of future tech and opportunity as an early adopter. Don't be left out. To register, go to bftexpo.com. That's blockchainfuturetechexpo.com. Thank you.
Hi, and welcome to the Future Tech Podcast. I'm Alan Thomas, and today I have with me John Hornick of Finnegan. .com. How are you doing, John?
I'm fine. How are you today?
Doing pretty good. Pretty good. So let's just get right into it. What is Finnegan? What do you guys do?
Well, Finnegan is one of the largest intellectual property law firms in the world. And intellectual property, you know, is patents and trademarks and copyrights and trade secrets. And I was a partner there for 25 years. I'm now senior counsel. We have offices all over the world. And what we do basically is we help companies to protect their intellectual property. And over the last several years, I've been focusing on the 3D printing industry. And I formalized our practice in that area, started our 3D printing working group. And what that group does is helps companies who are in the 3D printing space protect and enforce and monetize their IP.
And so what attracted you in particular to the 3D printing space, to that particular area?
Well, several years ago, a friend of mine sent me a video of a machine printing out a wrench. And I thought, well, this is probably a joke, but if it's real, it's important technology. And I sent that video to several friends, and I said the same thing I just said to you. This is probably a joke, but if it's real, it's important. And one of them wrote back. He was the chief architect at Johns Hopkins University Hospital. And he said, this isn't a joke. We have doctors here who are trying to do this with human organs. And it's going to be a few years, but it's real. So at that point, I thought, well, I wonder if my firm has done any work in this area. And it turned out that we had. I hadn't myself, but the firm had. So I pulled our practice together into a more formalized practice and put together what I call the 3D printing working group. And then my interest in this field went way beyond the law. And I started a database to keep track of what was happening in the industry. And after not too long, I realized I had enough to write a book. So I wrote a book called 3D Printing Will Rock the World. And that's done very well. It's won a couple of awards. And that's really taken me down to completely different avenues, not just doing IP, but also dealing with companies who are looking for strategic advice in the 3D printing area.
And so now you're kind of become a, sort of a go-to consultant in this area, in the, kind of the, in 3D printing field?
Yeah, I wouldn't say a consultant across all areas. There, you know, my areas of consultation really tend to be somehow related to intellectual property or also to law enforcement. That's another area where I've been doing 3D printing consulting.
Now, in terms of law enforcement, what exactly what applications would there be in law enforcement?
Well, in 2013, there was a lot of news about some people who were 3D printing guns out of plastic. And there initially in 2013, there was a lot of hype about that. And the gun that was 3D printed at that time was fairly primitive. But since that time, there has been a lot of work by a lot of mostly anonymous people who are developing the 3D printing of weapons. And also, 3D printing has been used by law enforcement to help to solve crimes. So I have put together a series of courses for an online platform called Law Enforcement Learning. It's at lawenforcementlearning.com. You have to have a badge to take a course on that platform. You know, you have to be in law enforcement. And so I've developed some courses for that platform to teach law enforcement people about the risks and the benefits of 3D printing. So I have a course on 3D printed weapons, and that's not just guns, but it's also things like lower receiver for AR-15s, it's bump fire stocks, it's bullets. And then I put together another course called 3D Printing 101 for law enforcement. And I'm putting together a course now on 3D printing as an aid to law enforcement.
In order to help them solve cases or become more effective at their work, right?
Exactly.
And so the I guess the ultimate goal or mission of your practice area, like I know you said you focus on IP in particular. But what would you say is the ultimate goal or focus of your practice area? I mean, beyond where it is right now.
Well, you know, like I said, I was a partner at Finnegan for 25 years, and during that time, I was really practicing law. I was helping clients with their IP portfolios. I was litigating cases in the IP area. I was helping companies to commercialize their technology. I was writing contracts that were used in all types of IP. Over the last 5 years, though, I've been doing those same things, but focusing more on, or almost exclusively, I should say, on 3D printing. But starting the beginning of this year, I became a senior counsel to the firm, and now I'm kind of branching out. I'm doing some consulting that's not purely IP related, like the law enforcement consulting that I mentioned.
So I know you've done a lot of, like you said, you've done a lot of casework. You've been involved in a lot of different situations. What are some of the more difficult, cases that you've come across in working in this area, or some of the more difficult problems you've had to solve, I guess?
Well, a topic that I have written a lot about and that I've spoken a lot about is a concept that I pioneered called away from control. And away from control means the ability to use 3D printing to make something without anyone knowing about it and without anyone being able to control it. And that's basically, I think, the concept that the guy who 3D printed the first gun, I think that's the concept that he was experimenting with too. He was asking the question, what would the consequences be if someone was able to 3D print a gun without anyone knowing about it and without anyone being able to control it? And that's what I call away from control. And this is something that will become more widespread because 3D printers democratize manufacturing. They make it possible for anyone to manufacture almost anything. And, you know, the machines are not necessarily inexpensive. I mean, the top machines in this area cost up to $5 million. But people who have the resources, whether that's a small or medium-sized business, they can use 3D printing to compete with the big dogs. And what we'll start to see more of is what I refer to as 3D printing away from control. Now, if anyone can make anything without anyone knowing about it and without anyone being able to control it, that raises real problems for intellectual property owners because they might have intellectual property rights, they might have patents, they might have trade secrets, they might have copyrights. But if anyone can make what's covered by that IP without anyone knowing about it, without anyone being able to control it, that means that their IP could become essentially valueless, you know, or irrelevant. It would exist, but it would be impractical or impossible to enforce it. So, you know, that's an issue that I think that's the most difficult issue in the 3D printing space. And to some extent, I think it's unsolvable. But that doesn't mean that companies shouldn't have strong IP portfolios and strong licensing portfolios. And also, you know, you've probably heard of digital rights management. That's a way to lock up technology. And that may have some limited application as well. There may be applications for the blockchain in this area as well.
And I know you said that 3D, and I know this as well, 3D printers aren't necessarily cheap to get, but eventually the cost of them will probably come down to a point where this could become a more widespread problem, right?
Yeah, I think that's right. You know, right now there are really two sides to the 3D printing industry. There's a consumer side and there's an industrial side. Someone made an arbitrary cutoff that any machine that costs less than $5,000 is a consumer-grade machine. So consumer-grade machines run from a few hundred dollars up to about $5,000, and they're, you know, they the more you spend within that range, the more powerful they are, but still they're fairly primitive machines. The machines that run from $5,000 up to $5 million, they're much more sophisticated. They can make sophisticated parts. They can make parts out of metal. But what we'll start to see, I think, is some of the innovations in the consumer space will start to trickle up to the industrial space, and some of the innovations in the industrial space will start to trickle down, and there'll be less of a distinction between a consumer-grade machine and an industrial-grade machine. There'll just be different price ranges, and prices have been rising over the past few years in the industrial space, but eventually the machines will probably become more commoditized and prices will drop while technological capability increases.
So, John, have there been any materials or I guess any limitations on what can be made with 3D printers? Have we run into any limitations yet in terms of materials that can be used or objects that can be made?
Well, there are thousands and thousands of materials that can be printed or used in one or more different kinds of 3D printing technology. But the limitation really has been more parts versus products. Now, you know, there's probably the poster child for 3D printing has been a fuel nozzle that GE uses in one of their aircraft engines. And that, when made by traditional manufacturing, had 18 to 20 parts. And so you could view that as a product because it had a lot of parts. But now it's being 3D printed in one part. So that part has become a product, basically. But that's really not typical of most products. Most products are made up of a lot of different parts, and only some of them are being 3D printed. And so there are very few products that are being printed. So, for example, if you were to look at your smartphone, well, no one's printed a smartphone yet. That's made up of a lot of different parts. So I think where we're going to start to see advancement and where we've seen kind of limitations up to this point is we're going to start to see machines that are more capable of making products rather than parts. And one company I know that's making some great advancements in this area is a company called Enscript that's located in Florida. They have machines that are more directed toward making products rather than parts. And that's one of the companies that I do some consulting for. But we're going to see more of that. We're going to see more companies that are focusing on how to make a full product, whether it's a smartphone or whether it's a weather station or whether it's a set of headphones or, you know, whatever it might be, rather than just the parts that go into those things.
So when we talk about products being made rather than parts with the printers, does that mean that, let's say we get to a point where they're affordable enough for maybe the average person or close to it, something like that, and let's say a bunch of different parties start making, let's say the type of stuff that we buy on places like Amazon or eBay now, like very baby toys or something like that. Does that mean that would that entire categories of products, the cost could be driven down because the markets would be flooded?
Well, it's hard to say whether the price of products would be driven down. A lot of things could happen. One is people could start just making them themselves, so there may not be a market for the products anymore. In other words, if companies say, hey, why should we take on all the overhead of manufacturing products when we can just basically give the digital blueprints to customers and let them make the product themselves. But, you know, one area where we need to be able to advance is with 3D printed electronics. I mean, a lot of products that are out there, they have electronics in them. So if you're going to make the product, you're going to have to be able to 3D print the electronics as well. And some people say, well, you print what you can and pick what you print what you can and pick what you can. And picking means to use a pick and place mechanism to place, for example, a chip. So let's say you wanted to 3D print a smartphone. Well, you know, right now you can't 3D print the chips that are in it. So you print what you can, and you would pick and place what you can't. So let's say that some company says, well, we would like people to be able to do that in their own homes. So, you know, you'd have machines that are more sophisticated than we have now, but also fairly low in price. And what a company might do is they might send you a package, and the package might have all the chips that you need in it. And then you have a printer that can print all the rest. So you load the chips into the machine, and then you load the material into the machine, and then the machine prints you a phone by printing what it can and picking what it can. So that type of thing, I think we'll start to see that happening. You know, it'll start off fairly primitively at first, but to think that we won't be doing that eventually, I think, is kind of short-sighted, because, you know, the future is a really long time, and technology, we know how fast that develops. So eventually, and I think probably within, eventually means within about 10 years, we will start to see that type of product being manufactured, if not in the home, then maybe in a local shop that does it for you, that customizes it for you. But, you know, in not too much time, I think we'll see those things being done both in the home and in local businesses.
So in that example, I could customize my phone pretty much any way I wanted, and then XYZ phone company would send me, like you said, the parts that I would need that my printer couldn't pick up or wouldn't be able to duplicate. And I would basically end up assembling it like a model kit almost.
Right. And, you know, the first phones that are able to do that are going to be more like flip phones. They're not going to be as sophisticated as a smartphone. But, you know, technology marches on, and eventually we'll probably be able to 3D print almost anything, either by printing what you can and picking what you can't, or eventually we may be able to print everything.
And see, I was okay with flip phones. I just let it go because it went out of style. So I'm looking forward to that.
Flip phone is coming back. I hear it's coming back. So, you know, we'll see.
Yeah, I would love that to put together my own. Sure. Nice and personalized.
Well, that's the beauty of 3D printing is customization. And, you know, right now everyone thinks in terms of mass production. So, you know, I'm often asked, is 3D printing ever going to be suitable for mass production? And I say, well, you may be asking the wrong question, because if we move toward a world where we personalize all of our products, customize all of our products, then there will be less of a need for mass production, more of a need for mass customization. And if you're doing mass customization, then you don't have to worry, you don't have to have the speed and the scale of mass production.
And that was going to be my next question. That was a great segue into that, about just in terms of speed to be able to, I mean, it would be great to be able to do these things, but what are we looking at in terms of speed? Are we talking about hours or days or maybe even weeks, for depending on what the product is or how complex it is? Does that dictate the speed?
Yeah, well, there are a lot of advancements being made in that area. You know, one of the complaints about 3D printing has been that it's fairly slow. And, you know, there's different types of technology. You've probably seen the machines that can print out Yoda heads. Those are the least expensive machines. They're material extrusion machines. And they, you know, you can get one of those for a few hundred dollars. And they're fairly slow. But HP, for example, has entered into the 3D printing space, and they came out with a machine that they call multi-jet fusion or jet fusion. And it's much faster. It's orders of magnitude faster than material extrusion. And so They're making advancements in that area. There's another process called high-speed sintering that's supposed to rival the speed of injection molding. 3D Systems has a machine that they say rivals the speed of injection molding. So when we get to that point, when machines are as fast as injection molding, and maybe we're there or we're close to being there, then it will be practical to have customization at a speed that people are comfortable with. I mean, right now, you know, people are used to ordering things online and getting them within 2 days. So people have kind of come to expect that they can get almost anything they want within a couple of days. So if you're doing customized 3D printing and somebody says to you, well, it's going to take a week, or even if they say it's going to take 4 days, you might say, well, that's too long. So I think once we can get it down to where you can get pretty much anything you want within a 2 day period of time, people will probably be happy with that. And, you know, if you're talking about going into retail stores, you know, that some people think they're dying, but even if they're not dying, people still want that to be relatively fast. Will it ever be fast enough that you can walk into the store and order something right there and have it made customized while you wait? I think that that's going to be a while before it can be that fast. Could it be that you come back the next day? I think that's possible. Will it be that it will never be within a couple hours? Well, no. Again, the future is a long time, so I think eventually it'll be fast enough that you can get it within a couple of hours. By that time, people might not be going into stores anyway.
Well, you're right about that. And maybe a side effect of the onset of 3D printing will be, in that example that you were using where we go into the store and we have to maybe wait 4 or 5 days when we place the order, maybe a side effect of that will be that our patience as consumers increases again. Instead of, you know, now that we've gotten down to this, oh, I need it in hours or I need it in a day and a half.
Well, and you're right about that. It's possible that as we move toward a more of a customization culture, our expectations may change. Right now, we do expect to get anything that's mass produced very, very quickly. But if we were able to get exactly what we want, but it's going to take a day or two, you're right. People may adjust to that.
It's all about desire. You know, like you said, if it's perfectly customized, then I think, it would force people into that box. They'd have no choice. You know, technology.
Well, it's about expectations.
So much.
Yeah, you're right. It's about expectations too. I mean, if people are educated that, you know, that they can have a product that's customized to their wants, but they may have to wait a little bit of time for it. They may adjust to that if you adjust their expectations.
And so definitely, and so with this technology, you can definitely do a lot. But at this point, and you've kind of touched on it a little bit already, but at this point, have there been any ideas or concepts people have kind of brought across your desk where you would just automatically say, well, that would be umpteen years away. You just wouldn't be able to do that within the next 2 years or 3 years. Any developments like that?
Well, there's a difference between, there's a big spread between umpteen and 2 or 3. And what I say in most cases is that, I think we'll see the ability to make almost anything within about 10 years' time. You know, that Bill Gates said that we overestimate the things we can do in 2 years and we underestimate the things we can do in 10. And technology is moving very quickly, and I have heard people say, for example, you know, there's a side area of 3D printing called bioprinting, and there are people who are working on 3D printing human organs, which I mentioned at the very beginning of this interview. And I've heard people say, well, it's you know, we're not going to have a 3D printed or bioprinted human heart for probably 20 or 30 years. And then there's a company in California that announced that they did a miniaturized version about 2 years ago. So I think that we will see all of these things much quicker than you think.
Wow. I can't believe somebody. I mean, it didn't surprise me that somebody was already working on it, but the fact that they've already done a version of it, even a miniaturized version, I mean, already, like, yeah, that definitely blows expectations out of the water. Yeah.
Well, it's, you know, I think it was fairly primitive, but the point is that it's a start, and there's a difference between saying it's going to be a few years before we do it, and it's going to, on the one hand, on the other hand, saying it's going to be a few years before we perfect it. Two totally different things. And you know, if we have an example of something that's already been done and it was primitive, but now it's a matter of improving on it rather than doing it in the first place. And so, you know, once you've actually gotten something, you've gotten a start, then improvements come along pretty fast.
Oh, exactly. Once you have that base, you just keep refining, right? Just like anything else.
Exactly. Right. Right.
And so, what big takeaway or final thoughts do you have for our listeners? From the information that you've given us today, what would you like them to kind of take away from the interview?
Well, one thing is that 3D printing is alive and well. Back in 2013 and 14, there was a lot of hype about it. And a lot of people were following it, and they were very interested in it. And then, you know, like everything else, it kind of falls out of the news. And the news media moves on to something else. So some people are tempted to think that 3D printing is going away, it's not successful, and most people tend to think of 3D printing as those machines that make the Yoda heads, too. They don't really know anything about the industrial side. So what I would say to people is, you know, keep your eye out for it, and don't be surprised when you see things come along, and 3D printing is alive and well, and it's growing at a pretty healthy compound annual growth rate.
Wow. Well, that's just amazing stuff. And John, what's the best way for our listeners if they want to find out more, if they want to engage with you about the subject? Where do they need to go?
Well, they could read my book, 3D Printing Will Rock the World. That goes into great detail about a lot of things that I've talked about today. The easiest way to get it is on Amazon or on Barnes & Noble's website. I can be contacted at John Hornick, john.hornick@finnegan.com. And, you know, I'm out there speaking and writing quite often, so people may run across one of my presentations or one of my papers. I have several videos on YouTube as well, if you search my name and 3D printing.
Okay, well, again, I want to thank you, John, for coming on to the podcast and giving us all this great information. And just, you know, we appreciate your time and we appreciate your expertise.
Well, thanks for having me. It was my pleasure.
Coming to Dallas, Texas, September 14th, 15th, and 16th, 2018, the Blockchain and Future Tech Expo. This is going to be a gigantic conference of over 5,000 people. We're going to be talking about blockchain and its applications. We're going to be talking about quantum computing, cybersecurity, artificial intelligence, and several other future technologies that are poised to and actually changing our lives as we speak. Here's why you should attend. As you may know, early adopters are the ones that investigated and profited from things like the gold rush in the 1800s, from the dot-com boom in the 1990s, from the internet boom in 2005, from the smartphone explosion in 2007, from the real estate boom that ended in 2008, and of course, from the Bitcoin boom that started in 2012. Early adopters act now. They don't wait till later. They go out west first. In their covered wagons, they find the biggest gold nuggets. If you consider yourself an early adopter and you want to find the biggest nuggets, then you owe it to yourself to attend this upcoming conference. Blockchain is going to affect how we control and store our medical data, how we send money around the world, how we bank, and more. But artificial intelligence, quantum computing, and cybersecurity will play a pivotal role in our lives as well. And that's why our next event, September 14th to the 16th at the Dallas Convention Center, is going to have not only 5,000 plus attendees, but we'll showcase blockchain, AI, cybersecurity, quantum computing, and more. You want to get in on the coming gold rush of future tech and opportunity as an early adopter. Don't be left out. To register, go to bftexpo.com. That's blockchainfuturetechexpo.com. Thank you. You have been listening to Almost Here, Around the Corner Future Technology Podcast with Richard Jacobs. Subscribe to this podcast, post a review, to discover more future technologies that are poised to transform our lives for better or worse, such as Bitcoin, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, blockchain, virtual reality, and more.